So, our sponsors make this happen. Thank you, thank you, thank you. This talk is sponsored by Sandy and Dave Whitmore in honor of my work here. And that just, I am so humbled. And I thank you so much. That really means so much to me. And they've been with us since the beginning. So they are great Craniac supporters. If anyone out there is interested in becoming a supporter and sponsor of one of our webinars, please contact Kate Fitzwilliams at that number or kate@savingcranes.org. Thank you, Sandy and Dave. So appreciated. Okay, everyone, we're going to do something a little bit different today. We are not going to do the usual PowerPoint web thing. What you're looking at is a story map, and the places where cranes are lends itself to kind of a geographic focus. So I thought, you know, if I'm going to do this, I'd like to make a map and include pictures and descriptions of the places where people can see cranes and make it a little interactive. So what this is going to do is be online eventually. And so people can go and browse through all of the places, at least for starters, in North America, where we can see our two species of crane. With any luck, if I get really ambitious, we'll try to make it global. So here's how a story map works, and we'll have this big old map. And for those of you that have been in on a couple of my other presentations on sandhills, you'll recognize this as the range map of sandhill cranes. And this green is the breeding area. Yellow are all the wintering areas, and then the few non-migratory populations as well. But superimposed on this is we have our Aransas wood buffalo population of whooping cranes and their narrow flyway. And here we have the eastern migratory population of whooping cranes over here. So you can see they overlap with a lot of these sandhill crane flyways. And so what we'll do today is we will browse through some of these flyways and talk about where we can see sandhills of various populations and places where we can see whooping cranes at the same time. And I think in the chat box, we've already shared with you some of those previous presentations that we have done talking about those cranes. So you can go back and learn a little bit more in depth about those sandhill crane flyways. So Cranes 365, and I chose that name because these are areas where any time of the year, if we go to a certain place in North America, at least the lower 48, we can go and see cranes and whooping cranes and sandhills. And I like the ratio here in this picture. It's fantastic. So the map over on the right are the places that we will talk about today. And I have been to these places and I can talk a little bit more in depth about some of them, but this is not exhaustive. And so that's why I wanted folks to really tell everyone else where they love to go and see cranes. Sometimes it's their own backyard and they might not want crowds of people. But a lot of these places can accommodate all of you that would love to go and see a sandhill crane festival or whooping cranes in their breeding grounds, perhaps. So let's browse through just these and we'll talk about the who, when, and what to look for in these places. And the highlight, as I go through, the pin will highlight of where I'm talking. And as this map goes live on our website, I will add in more of the crane places that you all love and more of the festivals, and we'll fill it out a lot more. And it will be a very dynamic resource for you to go back to over and over again. Let's get started with crane places. Of course, I'm going to start right here at home. Here in Baraboo, Wisconsin, the only place in the world you can see all 15 species, and we're so proud of that. Well, the other thing that we are proud of is our new renovation, and we are so happy to open on May 1st, 2021. That's right around the corner, people. We're so excited. We've been closed for way too long, and we want to welcome you back. So I'll show you a little bit of what you can expect. Here is our new George Archibald Welcome Center. New gift shop, new exhibits, inside of this is just phenomenal. New prairie plantings. What else do we have? This is something that is really stunning. This is our cranes and culture exhibit. And there's a nice little courtyard here where people can find maybe respite from the heat and shade. And we have these beautiful handcrafted prayer wheels from Tibet, full of actually prayers and thoughts from staff and volunteers. So every time you go by and you spin those wheels, all of our thoughts will go up into heaven and hopefully be heard. This is our hope. And here's our lovely Red Crown Crane fountain sculpture. So worth it just to see that, right? We have all new exhibits for many of our birds. Here's our blackneck crane with a beautiful new mural in the background. They have brand new ponds that they can walk around in. And this is the actual view of that bird. You notice that there is no fence in front of you. This is a clear view of that bird in its exhibit. So it's really, you can get in there and personal with these cranes. It's wonderful. We also have all sorts of new interpretive signs that we can't wait to teach you more about each of these species and the places where they are. And here is our new blackneck cranes. I just threw those in. The beautiful mural in the background and again with those beautiful birds in their new exhibit. It's just lovely. I hope to see so many of you after May 1st of this year. Moving on, let's move west. Yampa Valley Crane Festival. I have had the honor, the privilege of speaking at this festival. It's lovely. This is an absolutely lovely festival in Steamboat Springs, Colorado. And this is near the fall staging area of the Rocky Mountain population of sandhill cranes. Their festival occurs over Labor Day weekend every year. And look at that. That's the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, people. You can go out and see the cranes in the fields, and the Colorado Crane Coalition has set up a program called Crops for Cranes to ensure that these migratory birds have enough forage as they're moving through this area on their way south. Here, you might recognize one of the lovely, lovely speakers that they've had at the Yampa Valley Crane Festival. This is George Archibald. So they have a absolutely stunning array of speakers, of classes, birding. They have live bird shows. Of course, they take tours out to see the cranes. And they also have a beautiful art exhibit. They have people make cranes that you can judge. They have children's art exhibits. They have dance, everything. It is a lovely, lovely festival. And in a stunning, stunning setting, I gotta say. Visit them. Let's stay in the Rocky Mountain population flyway. Those birds will end up eventually in Bosque del Apache National Wildlife Refuge. And I saw that there's a couple of people that mentioned that as their favorite crane place. And this is literally an oasis. Lots and lots of migratory waterfowl have used this for millennia as their wintering areas. So again, this is the Rocky Mountain population of sandhill cranes. As they move through, there's Deb Caldwell from the Friends of the Bosque Refuge Friends Group. And she invited me down. And here is the Rio Grande River in this beautiful valley. And this is where the cranes and geese and other waterfowl gather. Absolutely, again, stunning, stunning setting. Look at that. The amount of birds that you can see there with the mountains in the background is phenomenal. Whoop, I can't skip over that. Places like this, as you watch the birds come into roost or you go early in the morning and watch the light come up and see the cranes as they're warming up and getting ready to go out into the fields for the day to forage, is absolutely a stunning sight. And they also have a week-long festival, usually around Thanksgiving time, and they have loads and loads of courses that you can take, a lot of photography courses, but also birding and other exhibits that they have at the visitor center of the refuge. So it's a really, really great place to spend a lot of time watching cranes. further west. Let's go all the way over to California, the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta, just east of San Francisco. So the Central Valley of California is also a huge wintering area for millions of waterfowl and lots of cranes that gather from the Pacific Flyway. So this is birds from as far up as Alaska through British Columbia and greater sandhill cranes that only commute from as far as their breeding grounds in Oregon and Washington state. And so from October to February, there's loads of birds that are using the rice fields here, but also come into these lovely protected areas, and there's viewing stations where you can go and see these birds come in to roost. And here's our good friend Paul Tebble giving kind of an interpretive tour on Staten Island. And you can see this is within the Delta. So back here, this hill is actually a levee, and the river system is behind it. And so they talk here about wildlife-friendly farming that goes on in these protected areas, and as they prepare for the birds to come down in the winter. And you can get wonderful, wonderful views of all of these birds and other waterfowl as they're using this gorgeous area just outside of San Francisco. Moving back right in the middle of the country, this gorgeous, gorgeous refuge in the middle of Kansas, Quivira National Wildlife Refuge, just west of the Flint Hills, which I have to say is worth a visit in itself. Wonderful. This is a Ramsar site. So this is a wetland of international importance. There's quite a few crane areas that have this designation. And this refuge is unique. The lakes that the birds use are saline, and it is a function of how the hydrology is in these areas. There's a lot of evapotranspiration and leaving a lot of salts behind. And so there's a very interesting ecosystem, and it's a beautiful sand prairie landscape surrounding it. And here, the Central Flyway Sandhills will use this in the spring and the fall. And they have actually a festival that they have just recently started in the fall, also in November. But so many birds use this area. It is glorious, including cranes. So here we see so many of the sandhills that are coming down through the Central Flyway. And if you hit the day right, we missed it by one day when we visited. There were a dozen whooping cranes that were using these marshes the day before we visited, because naturally, when we did manage to see a family group the day that we were there, but the whooping cranes that are coming down from the breeding grounds in Wood Buffalo National Park do use this refuge as well. Very much an oasis. Very critical at this life stage of their this stage of the annual cycle of these birds. So they're all headed down this way, those whooping cranes. Some sandhills as well, but Aransas National Wildlife Refuge on the Texas coast is definitely known for their whooping cranes. And so this is a wonderful winter getaway. Take a boat tour. You can go out and see the cranes from the boat. Fantastic photography opportunities. You can see them taking those blue crabs that they are so famous for eating down there. And you know, if you go out to lunch, partake of them yourself. This is from a observation deck in the refuge. It's just this gorgeous, gorgeous view of this Texas landscape. And you can see the birds with in their family groups, perhaps. And again, the adult is teaching that chick of the year how to eat those blue crabs without getting poked in the eye. That delicious, delicious meal. And you can actually see that the bird obviously has a transmitter on its leg, and there is still an active banding program with this population of whooping cranes. So we can learn more about them and continue our protections for these birds. And of course, there is much, much more wildlife, bird life and wildlife in these coastal estuaries. It's just a lovely, lovely place to visit. Let's stay. Nope, I think I was gonna think thought we were gonna stay along the coast. We'll come back. But let's go up into a different flyway. So now we're in the flyway of the eastern population of sandhill cranes, and the eastern migratory population of whooping cranes in northern Alabama and Decatur, this urban wildlife refuge called Wheeler. And this is a fantastic place. In the last several decades, more and more sandhills and now whooping cranes are using that as a wintering area. And they have a festival in January, but you can go inside of this beautiful viewing deck that is literally in the middle of the cranes. And it is filled with not just the sights, but also the sounds. They have microphones that are placed outside in these pools that are gathering up all the crane calls and the quacking ducks and all of that myriad bird sound and piping it inside. So it absolutely feels like you are out there and immersed in the birds. It's wonderful. You can see, again, both whooping cranes and sandhill cranes, quite a few whooping cranes, upwards sometimes almost a quarter of the eastern migratory population of whooping cranes will use Wheeler in the wintertime. And you can see there, we can easily identify those birds. It's fantastic to be able to see them that well, and all the sandhills as well. Remembering that some of those sandhills might be banded, so always look at their legs. You never know what you're going to find. And again, they have a January festival that takes place at the refuge and in town, and they have so many wonderful exhibits and presentations. It's a great, great thing to do, and ICF often takes part in that festival as well. Here we go. How about we go back to the coast? So the Mississippi Sandhill Crane National Wildlife Refuge. This is a 365 day a year crane experience, because this is where you can find the non-migratory subspecies of sandhill. They are endangered. This refuge was created specifically for the protection of this bird, but also this ecosystem. This is some of the last little remnants of wet pine savanna. And you can see that beautifully in this picture here. Just a gorgeous, gorgeous place. And this is kept open and intact like this because they do prescribed fires on a regular basis. And these pines and these plants are adapted to fire. And so they require it to keep this refuge looking so gorgeous like this. And those are pitcher plants. The most of the areas are well known for their parasitic plants. There's quite a few of them that can be found on the refuge, and they are just fantastic. If you've never seen flowering pitcher plants or sundews, they're really a stunning, stunning thing. Their visitor center also has wonderful interpretive exhibits. This is a fairly new visitor center. So take that a winter break and go to coastal Mississippi and visit our friends at the Mississippi Sandhill Crane Wildlife Refuge. Oh, moving north. So here's a spot where you can see a lot of cranes October, November, December. And this is very close to downtown Chicago. Jasper Pulaski Fish and Wildlife Area. And this used to be a very important and well-used stopover on the annual migration south for our sandhill cranes and whooping cranes. But now, quite a bit, it is being utilized as a wintering area. So these birds, if the weather turns really bad, so very, very cold or snowy, these birds might stay. But often you will find them there at least through December. And they have this viewing deck. This is an older picture. They've modified it since then, but they have this beautiful viewing deck that overlooks this very large field where the birds will stage before they go into the pools that are in the refuge to roost for the evening. And if you're lucky, we will have an interpretive person from the International Crane Foundation to answer all of your questions. And as you watch the sunset behind you there from that viewing deck, that large field there becomes filled with cranes. Imagine all of this filled with cranes. And then right before dark, they hop over the trees and go to bed for the night. And more than likely these days, you'll be able to find a whooping crane in those flocks. So it's a really, really nice little spot up in northwestern Indiana. So we've been talking a lot, mostly about wintering areas or perhaps staging areas, but there are places where you can go and see lovely places and breeding cranes as well. And one that we know very, very well here from the Crane Foundation is the Nisida National Wildlife Refuge. So some of you may recognize that name as the original release spot for whooping cranes in this, what was then the newly reintroduced Eastern migratory flock. So here we have the beautiful new visitor center. Again, it's already a decade old, but it seems like it's still so new. Wonderful exhibits there. And you can walk out onto this boardwalk right out into the wetland areas and see these beautiful, beautiful sedge meadows that they have up there. It's absolutely a glorious ecosystem. And you can go up into the viewing tower and look over some of these pools, and you can look down. There are whooping cranes that are nesting in this pool, and also many sandhill cranes and trumpeter swans as well. And so I mentioned in the text that it is not only famous for its endangered whooping cranes, but it has several other species that are threatened or endangered, such as red-headed woodpeckers and Karner blue butterfly, which is another federally endangered species. So there's a lot to enjoy at Nisida. If we hop over to the western side of Wisconsin, we see Horicon National Wildlife Refuge. And now this is also a spot where we have now breeding whooping cranes and sandhill cranes. This is another Ramsar site. So I had mentioned that earlier. This is a wetland of international importance, and not because this was assigned before they had whooping cranes. So it is just a stunning place. That their wonderful visitor center here also has exhibits that you can go and see, and species like yellow-headed blackbirds, now nesting black-neck stilts, and black-crowned night herons. So there a lot of people visit this area to see birds that they can see no place else in Wisconsin. And this nice foggy day, it's much more thick vegetation here and cattails as compared to Nisida. So very different ecosystem. And there's our little black-crowned night heron that you can see going by. And they have wonderful canoe trails that you can get out into the marsh. And they also have boat tours that you can do and really get immersed in this refuge. Wonderful. Well, if you were wondering if I was ever going to get to the Platte River, I had to save it for last. I may be unarguably the jewel in the crown of crane migration in North America. Just, I hope that so many of you listening today have been here, and I hope that others that haven't been here can go. It is a phenomenal place to see the mid-continent population of sandhill cranes gather in the spring as they pile in and wait to move north, wait for all of their breeding areas up in Canada and Alaska and even Siberia to thaw. And they rest here and they refuel. And if you wait a little bit later than mid-March, you'll see some whooping cranes. They tend to go a little bit later. But do visit our friends at Roe Audubon Sanctuary. They've had a rough few years of closures due to pandemic and weather closures even the year before that. So they are open for business right now on a limited basis, but please visit them virtually and see all of that they have to offer for sandhill cranes and habitat protection like this. You can see how they work to keep these islands open. So all of these cranes have a place to roost. And if you look close, you can see underneath here these sandbars. That is what the birds are roosting in, just a few inches of water off of these islands on these beautiful sandbars. But it has to be open like this. They can't use these areas that are forested. So the Crane Trust and Roe Audubon Sanctuary do a lot of work to keep these rivers open for the birds every spring. And if you are lucky enough to score a spot in a Roe Sanctuary blind, this is what you might see. And this is what I saw one morning when all of the birds had a big liftoff instead of leaving in smaller groups and twos and threes. All of the birds, maybe spooked by an eagle or something like that, they all got up at once. And I it was jaw-dropping. And the noise was spectacular. And it was just such a joy to be able to behold that. So I do hope that you're able to visit someday soon and see that. And I had to throw this in here because this is a place that I love to go when I see the cranes when I go to visit Nebraska. This is the Museum of Nebraska Art in Kearney, Nebraska, the MONA. And every year they have, in one of their main galleries, they have one of these big installations. And this was so stunning to me as a crane biologist, but also just loving the crane art themes that they have every year in March. This bird floating out of the sky to that flat land and that meandering river. It was just so stunning. So if you do visit, please make sure to put the Museum of Nebraska Art on your agenda. They always have such wonderful and thoughtful installations and other crane art and local Nebraska art. Well, that is a brief tour of some crane areas that I have been to, that I can speak to. Knowing that there are so many other ones out there, I would love to talk. I'm joined somewhere back there by Lizzie Condon, and we can take questions.
Yeah, I have some questions for you, Anne. First of all, thank you so much for putting this together.
Yeah, a labor of love.
So I already answered a question. I think I answered it incorrectly, so I just want to clarify it now. Sure. Somebody asked if they could view this website after your talk, but it's still not public yet?
Correct. Yeah. Pretty soon, I just need to make some finishing touches, and I will add a lot of links in. So all of the links and things that I talked about and we posted in the chat will be linked in these paragraphs. So I want to make sure that that's there.
Okay.
The recording, you know, if that helps, the recording will always be there. But hopefully, if I can get to it, this interactive map will be available to people soon, I hope.
Yeah. Well, it's a really cool resource, and I am excited about it being available and ready. Okay, so I've got some questions. One is from Linda Schultz. How did Baraboo become the site for ICF?
Isn't it? It seems very random, doesn't it? Well, the story begins back with two graduate students, Ron Sowie and George Archibald, meeting at Cornell University, and they were both doing their PhD projects on cranes. And they got to talking about how cranes, as a family of birds, were some of the most endangered species in the world, or threatened at that time. Certainly the whooping crane was well known for being very, very endangered in North America. And they thought, you know what, we can maybe start a foundation. And they did. And it turns out that Ron Sowie just happened to be from Baraboo, Wisconsin. And his parents just happened to own a horse farm that had barns and lots of fencing already put up. And they superimposed a cranes of the world breeding site on a horse farm in Baraboo, Wisconsin. And of course, they kind of opened themselves up to show people around and share their mission. And that became an education department, and they soon outgrew it. And so they literally bought this farm where I'm sitting now, and made it into our new site. And we have been growing ever since, adapting and growing and becoming better and better every year since.
Yeah.
That's a very short story.
Yeah.
Should I stop sharing my screen? Hannah, do you have another one up behind there? I don't know if I should stop sharing.
I think it's fine either way. Okay.
Here we go.
I don't know if you know the answer to this or not, Anne. Were the cranes at Arantzas affected by the recent Texas deep freeze?
You know, we often get that question from people here. Hi, Lizzie. And when it snows or when it's cold, and are the cranes okay? So specifically, the cranes in Texas were fine. they have down coats on, which is really nice. And so they do super. The water did get very, very cold very quickly, but their legs are actually very well adapted to that kind of thing as well. They have a special circulatory system that keeps the warm blood up in their body, and it doesn't get cooled when it goes down into their legs. It actually works the opposite in the summertime to help them cool down, which is nice. But the people definitely fared worse in Texas than at least our population of whooping cranes and the sandhills did. They might have had to switch their food source because the blue crabs that they typically would feed on probably went for their deep dive and buried in the mud to get away from the cold. Mm-hmm. But the fish had a hard time of it. And so they had a large amount and varied amount of fish that they could choose from to feed on. So maybe not as good as blue crabs. We're actually not quite sure, but they did okay.
Okay, cool. Well, I just learned something new.
Yeah, yes.
Always learning stuff in these webinars. So we are getting several questions about when people can visit the Cranes of the World at the International Crane Foundation. Do you want to talk about where people can get information about that?
Yeah. Was that posted on the chat?
It was posted in the chat, but you know, there's a lot happening in the chat. So maybe people didn't.
Oh yeah. It's probably buried.
Yeah.
So absolutely everyone, if you're interested in our new grand opening, possibly planning a visit, please do plan ahead because we are doing a limited timed opening. So people will have to make reservations after May 1st so we can accommodate people safely here on site. And we want to know all of the rules to be safe here on site. So please visit www.savingcranes.org, and it should be right there on top, information about that, but also keep track on social media. If you do Facebook or Instagram or any of those things, a lot of the information will be posted there. But our website will absolutely have that and a direct link on how to make reservations.
We're all very excited about that.
Yes.
Okay, I have a question from Lisa Manzi. She's asking if there's more than one population of cranes, of whooping cranes.
Oh, yes.
And if so, how many whooping cranes are in each population about?
Gotcha. Well, we actually have three populations of whooping cranes now. 3.1. So there are technically two populations of non-migratory whooping cranes that are currently in the U.S. Both of those are reintroduced. One is much older in Florida, and there's only 9 birds left in that population because we have not been actively putting birds out onto the landscape, birds raised in captivity. And every now and again, one of them nests, but there is essentially no productivity in the Florida population. The newest reintroduction site is in coastal Louisiana. And so the Louisiana non-migratory population is growing. There's about 75 birds there. And so that they're nesting right now. Those birds, they had just started when the freeze hit Louisiana, but most of them have just started, and so they are right on time, and we hope for great things from that population. So the two migratory populations that I talked about, the eastern migratory population that we have breeding here in Wisconsin that migrates south, there's about 80 birds in that right now, and we continue also to augment this population with captive reared birds, as well as the Louisiana population. The Arantzas wood buffalo population, they estimate that there's about just over 500 birds in that population, which is, depending on if you're a glass half full or half empty type of person, is not very much for a population of birds, or it's a lot considering they came from 15 individuals at one point in time. So we choose to be glass half full and celebrate that they have that many birds in the population. So, and they winter here in Texas and go up and breed up in Wood Buffalo National Park in Canada.
Cool. Thanks, Anne. Okay. We're getting a lot of questions, which is great. So, I don't even know if I'm going to be able to ask any of my pre-prepared questions, but I might because I'm selfish. We've got a lot of questions, I think, from people in Wisconsin. One is, are there crane viewing tours offered by any Wisconsin bird clubs? Not that I'm aware of. Are you aware of that, Anne?
Crane specific tours? Well, I can make put in a plug for and I'm having a brain fart. Lizzie, help me out with Wisconsin.
Wisconsin Society for Ornithology.
Nope. They're a supporter of our whooping crane reintroduction. And they do
Natural Resources Foundation.
The Natural Resources Foundation of Wisconsin. I apologize to anyone out there that's listening. One of the brain fart things that happens. Thank you. Every year they have a phenomenal field trip program, offering all manner of wonderful things to do and see in Wisconsin. And we do 2 or 3 every year for them. That are, one is to the Crane Foundation. Mm-hmm. One is talking about the whooping crane reintroduction, and that happens in the CETA. Mm-hmm. And a Santal crane one, I saw somebody mentioned the gathering of cranes on the Wisconsin River between Portage and Wisconsin Dells. And we feature that in the fall sometimes as well. And they are all of the funds for paying to do those tours comes back and helps us with our crane conservation goals as well. The Natural Resources Foundation is a phenomenal supporter of our work. So thank you to them.
Yeah. Yeah. Awesome. I was also thinking that like Horicon Marsh on the state side, they do a evening crane viewing in the fall. A lot of these places that have cranes on their property might have some events for you to go to.
There are some. Sandhill Wildlife Refuge, that's a state property in north central Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. And they do special tours. I also think that they do one from the Natural Resources Foundation. But you can go there. There's quite a few places in Wisconsin where the cranes gather. And the Aldo Leopold Foundation, mm-hmm. right down the road, literally from us, our neighbors, on the Wisconsin River, they do crane viewing tours every winter now, and you can go to their website and look and see to make reservations for that. And their website has more information about Sandhill Cranes, Aldo Leopold, and the river.
Awesome. Somebody wants to know where to go to see baby Sandhill Cranes. I thought maybe you could talk about like good habitats and then time of year.
Sure. Oh boy. How many people out there have baby Sandhill Cranes in their backyard? Raise your hand. Here in the upper Midwest, the eastern population of sandhills, they just got back within the last week or two. And so they are busy setting up their territories and making sure that their mate is back and they're all getting reacquainted if they spent the winter apart. And we'll set about nesting soon. So we usually have the first hatching of sandhill cranes in the first few weeks of May. And so those would be first nests. If they re-nest, they can even hatch out in June. And so sometimes, you know, given Wisconsin wetlands, if you don't have them in your backyard, they might be hard to see. So you would be able to see young of the year when they're not so cute and fuzzy anymore, but they're bigger and they look almost as big as the adults in August and September. when the birds are starting to come out of the wetlands and the chicks can fly, and they're much more visible then.
Okay, cool. We have a lot of questions about migration. First, where do the Wisconsin, the birds that breed in Wisconsin, where do they migrate to? The whooping cranes.
The whooping cranes from Wisconsin follow that historic migration path that the sandhills do. So kind of to the south and east, with a few exceptions. Mm-hmm. So they can go all the way to Florida. And the idea was when we started the reintroduction of whooping cranes, famously, they were taught the migration route via Operation Migration, being led by Ultralight. And so in that way, they were taught the roadmap all the way down to Florida. And then they made their way back on their own. And every subsequent migration then, they could choose to winter in appropriate places anywhere in between. And because they have so many Sancho Crane cousins in a lot of these places, that also is a good indicator for the whooping cranes that they're good spots. So that might be why they often, the birds now do not go all the way to Florida, but they use these other great wintering areas with sandhills because they can find everything that they need to feed and stay safe overnight with that great water to roost in, everywhere in between.
Okay, great. And so another question I'm seeing is, why don't the cranes in Louisiana migrate?
They have everything that they need year round. Mm-hmm. So if we look into what it is that triggers migration of all of our creatures up here in northern latitudes, it is either that they cannot find safe roosting, so the water freezes, or their food sources are covered with snow, mm-hmm. or they don't have the body condition to allow them to safely overwinter. Everything that they need, there's nothing to really trigger them in those southern latitudes to migrate. However, there are wonderful exceptions that prove that rule, that we have had birds from both the Florida and the Louisiana non-migratory population go north for the summer, and they have made their way back. So when it comes to the whooping cranes, of course, they're all very, very related. You know, they have a pretty shallow gene pool. So mm-hmm. some of those ancient migratory genes might very well be there and be functional. And sometimes a non-breeding bird will get a wild hare and just maybe go north. Mm-hmm. But they do come back to those areas. And I think as they get older and settle on a territory and nesting, that drive may be blunted or go away. But every now and again, it does happen. It does happen that they make big movements that we would call migration.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's so interesting.
That's fascinating.
Okay. How, from Cecilia, how do they keep the cranes safe when they do the burns in Mississippi?
Oh, right. Actually, that is a very, very good question. They often know where the birds are nesting. And so the whole refuge is divided up into compartments, is what they call them. And those compartments are management units. And they all have, you know, this compartment needs to be burned because we have not had a prescribed fire there for X number of years. And so not all of those compartments have cranes nesting in them. And so they double check and make sure they can, back in when they could use drones, they would use drones to double check. But often it means walking in certain areas where a crane would nest and ensure that there are no nesting cranes in there. In areas where they do know that there are nesting birds and they do have a prescribed burn scheduled, they will go in and they will ensure that there's enough water around that nest that the fire will not actually get to it, mm-hmm. And protect it that way, to make sure that the fire does not harm them. They may very well be freaked out by the sound or the mm-hmm. smoke, mm-hmm. And leave the nest for a short period of time, but they will come back. And we have actually seen that here on our site where we do prescribed burns. And we have a wild pair of sandhill cranes that is nesting on our site. And we have seen them leave the nest and come right back and continue incubating, hatch. And they often successfully fledge the chicks when we have had a prescribed burn where they can lead the chicks in that new growth mm-hmm. that's very low. And they have a lot of buggy food sources. So it very much helps the cranes. Mm-hmm. I think.
Yeah. That's so fascinating. Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't know how to answer this question. So maybe you do.
This is a good one.
Thousands of sandhill cranes all fly at the same time. How do they not bump into each other?
I've had that same thought, and even more, I wonder how family groups have to stay together. How can they possibly stay together? Mm-hmm. I think they do probably bump into each other a little bit. but it probably isn't, you know, it isn't like bumper cars or anything like that, that they're going to, you know, knock them out of the sky. I do get the feeling that when we look at a flock of birds, it looks like they're piled very, very close together. Mm-hmm. In reality, there's probably a good buffer around them. And I think it is so loud when they all get up into the air at the same time is because they're all talking to each other and they do recognize each other's voice. Mm-hmm. And as long as they keep talking to each other, they know where they are at and they may go to their usual foraging area and regroup there mm-hmm. when they're back on the ground.
Yeah. Okay. Someone wants to know, is it possible to see cranes without going to one of these areas? Like, for example, do they fly over Chicago?
Oh, yeah. And we get a lot of reports mm-hmm. of birds, and especially at this time of year, spring and fall migration of birds flying right through downtown Chicago and right along the lakeshore even. So, yes. So in that range map that I had up originally, those arrows are obviously very generalized. And anywhere around there where that arrow is, obviously the scale is continental. So you are very likely to see birds in and around there, but it still has to be the right weather conditions for migration. And of course, in places like Wisconsin and Michigan, who have a lot of breeding sandhill cranes, chances of seeing them in the summertime throughout, you know, March all the way through November is very, very good. But some of those wintering and staging areas that I described in the talk are quite literally oases. Either in desert or in developed areas. And so you do really have to go to that place to see cranes because that is the only suitable habitat for maybe for miles around that those cranes can use safely.
Okay. We have a few different questions about genetic diversity and whipping cranes. You touched on it a little bit. I think some people are concerned for lack of genetic diversity. Can you talk about that at all?
I can answer genetics questions as a lay person mm-hmm. who has gleaned a lot of information from being at this organization. And we happen to have the coordinator of, it's going to happen again, Lizzie. SSP stands for Species Survival Plan, correct? Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of species in the world, mammal and bird and reptile and everything. And when it's a lot of the purpose of that is to ensure genetic diversity. So the lead of the SSP for whooping cranes happens to be right here at the Crane Foundation. And that is goal number one for our captive breeding centers throughout North America is to ensure that we continue to increase the genetic diversity of whooping cranes. Having said that, you have to keep in mind what we had to begin with. So it is a relative measure. Birds in general, you know, if you're talking to a geneticist, you'll get a lot of different answers. But that is absolutely something that we are working towards. And famously, Gee Whiz, who had very, very good genetics that we just lost, but his genes are spread throughout the crane world now, the whooping crane world specifically. But that's why he was very genetically valuable, and he definitely did his part for his species while he was alive. So thank you, Gee Whiz.
Yeah, rest in peace, Gee Whiz.
Yeah.
I'm going to ask a couple of my questions.
Sure.
One is, what is your favorite crane place?
Oh man. You know, I have a goal to try to see all of these places. Mm-hmm. So that's not exactly a favorite, but there's still a couple out there that I need to tick off the list.
Well, and I was going to ask you about that next, but
yeah. Oh yeah. I saw that somebody mentioned Creamer's Field up in Alaska, and I've heard so much about that. I would love to visit there. Mm-hmm. But I will have to say the Platte River. For all the reasons, it really, really is stunning. Mm-hmm. There's not enough words, so I'll stop. Mm-hmm. They're all great, but that is the greatest.
And then would you say that you answered it with my question was going to be, which crane place that you haven't been to, is that the top of your list?
Well, if it had to be domestic, yes. Internationally, again, there's people. I'm hoping to add in international spots for anybody that wants to go overseas to see the other 15 species.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, there's also some interesting places on the East Coast, which I didn't even get to, but there are sandhill cranes going up and down the Atlantic coast. And there are few, but there's starting to get places there where we can see cranes and they're breeding. And I would love to see some of those too. I haven't forgotten about you, East Coast, I promise.
What is your favorite international crane place that you have been to?
There is a very disjunct blue crane population that is breeding in northern Namibia in Etosha National Park. And again, these are salt pans, very not similar at all, but similar to Quivira in Kansas.
Mm-hmm.
And that was just such an amazing place. But no, I can't pick one because they're all just off the charts phenomenal. And I love visiting my friends that work over there for the Crane Foundation. And mm-hmm. it's lovely to have all of that.
Ugh. Yeah.
We're almost out of time, Lizzie. How do we kill?
I do want to mention, somebody asked, how can they view this again? Because it was a lot of great information. And we will be posting it on our YouTube channel probably by sometime early next week. We will have the webinar up, just like all of these webinars are available for you to watch and rewatch on our YouTube channel.
Yep. And as soon as I get this story map much more complete, that'll be up and available too. So keep those ideas coming in. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah. So how can all of these people who are watching, all these lovely people, how can they help cranes?
Cranes, you know what? There are myriad ways, but you know, the simplest way that folks can help cranes is by becoming a member of the International Crane Foundation. You know, we are a member organization, and man, oh man, we appreciate all of our members. And if you would like to support any of our specific programs, whooping cranes, sandhill cranes, if you'd like to donate to those, just let us know what you'd like to specifically donate to. That is phenomenal, and we thank you all for your help. Special thanks here again to Sandy and Dave Whitmore. Thank you for appreciating me, but more importantly, for seeing the importance of the International Crane Foundation's work. Thank you. Anyone out there, again, if you are interested in sponsoring one of these lovely webinars, please contact Kate at that number or kate@savingcranes.org. What do we have coming up next week? I think we have, there's our questions. Yep. And I think next week we have, or not next week, everyone, we are on a every other week schedule now. So please join us April 1st, no joke, Securing Waters for Cranes, Ourselves, and Our World by our president and CEO, Rich Belfis. And I think that might be his favorite crane, the wattled crane. I can't be sure, but you can ask him that in two weeks at 11 a.m. Central. So thank you one and all for joining us yet again. Keep your interest in the cranes, and I hope to see you on our site soon.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Lizzie.